Thank you all, and sorry to keep you waiting. We did just come out of an executive session, and we had already taken the roll, so we will start with announcements. Brian?
Yeah, so first of all, I wanted to mention that it is that time of the year where widows and widowers get flour and sugar from the village. So if you know of anyone that qualifies, please have them call the village, and that would be Ruth Ann at the regular extension. I also wanted to mention that Giving Tuesday is going to be a joint effort in the village this year with quite a few nonprofits participating. There's a website, ysgivingtuesday.com, and also the Community Foundation has provided matching funds for that effort. So this is the Tuesday after Thanksgiving, so that'll be the 29th. The Bulldog Jog, still time to sign up. That happens the day after Thanksgiving, and it's a great way to support our local schools. I wanted to highlight the Community Thanksgiving happening this Thursday at the Presbyterian Church, free for everybody. That's from 2 to 4 p.m., and I'll be cooking one of the turkeys, which will be moist and yummy. And I wanted to read something Patty gave me related to the broadband survey, which may already have been released or will be soon.
It will be before we go home for Thanksgiving.
Okay, great. So the Village of Yellow Springs has commissioned a broadband needs assessment to determine the feasibility of establishing a municipal broadband utility. As part of the process, broadband consultant Design 9 has created two surveys, one for business and one for residential. These surveys are available via links posted on the Village of Yellow Springs website and Facebook page. And we're asking that each business and residents complete the appropriate survey. There are three ways to complete them: via the link, you can print, complete, fold, and mail, or drop off at the village utility office. And we're really looking for a large response on this, and the deadline is December 31st. Okay.
Great. Anyone else? This weekend is, well, starting on Friday, it's Yellow Friday here in Yellow Springs. Since we don't want everybody to have to get in the traffic mess at the mall and fight with folks, just stay in Yellow Springs and have a relaxing shopping day on Friday. There will be carriage rides from 2 to 3 starting at the Little Art Theater. And I'd like to congratulate Asanda Imports on their 8th anniversary. And also pick up one of these. There's some outside. Lots of holiday events all the rest of the season. So there's lots going on, and remember to shop local. And actually, we do, to encourage that, there is going to be a shop local coupon book offering discounts and things at a lot of our shops. So you can buy those for $5, and the proceeds go to the Yellow Springs Coat Fund, the Mills Lawn PTO, and the Chamber Scholarship Fund.
And Karen, those carriage rides are Friday from 12 to 3?
Yes, Friday from 12 to 3, and they are absolutely free.
Nice.
Thank you. Moving on to the consent agenda. It includes the minutes of November 7th, October financials, and the treasurer's report. Can I get a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Review of the agenda. Is there anything that that we want to add to the agenda? Change or rework? Okay.
I just want to make sure, Patty, are we going to talk about the boardwalk project during your manager's report? Did you have a?
We can. I thought you were going to handle it under, you mean about the conversation today?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can certainly do that.
We can do that under the report for the glass farm.
Okay, great.
Okay. Brian, would you please review the petitions and communications?
Yes. So we received a letter from Dan Kerrigan, which was also in the Yellow Springs News, about the South College side path and his concern that that's not the way to go and that we should focus more on on-street biking. Laura Curlis also submitted a letter talking about the fact that downtown parking should not have a two-hour parking limit, and she also raised a concern about whether the upcoming bike corral would have such a limit. The Greene County Public Health issued a statement about a restaurant scam where basically someone's pretending to be from the public health department and trying to get credit card information, so be careful. We've got the mayor's monthly report, which showed business as usual. The Greene Memorial Hospital also submitted a report just highlighting the fact that they provide over, we'll see over 100,000 patients at least in 2015, and I think that was tied to the recent levy requests that they had. We got a report from Re-Energy for the third quarter showing what's being done in terms of using, I guess in particular, it's food byproducts to reduce carbon emissions, so there were some really great numbers on that.
That's actually our sewage sludge.
Yeah.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah, that's okay. Where we send our sewage sludge for disposal, and it's turned into clean energy.
So it was food byproduct at one point.
Yeah.
Oh. Food at one point, so.
That's yep. The way that they describe it in their statement.
I know, I really did.
So.
I thought the same thing. I thought it was like compost.
I was wondering.
Well, they do get food byproducts, yeah. Okay. Other sources.
Good, good. And then we did have something on the table from Christine Johnson, who highlighted the importance of recognizing the ADA aspects, so basically making sure that we're thinking about accessibility when we decide things like a trail or what we're going to do with Dayton Street, and I think that would apply to the entire village. So.
Yeah, Judy's going to read that letter since.
Oh, okay.
So when we get to that discussion. Thank you, Brian. We have lots of legislation, most of it second readings that we had last week, our last meeting. So as far as I can tell, until I stop you, you can read this all in by title only.
Outstanding. All right, so Ordinance 2016-23 is approving the right-of-way vacation request to vacate one alley off of West Center College Street.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Denise?
Okay. This is the second reading on the alley vacation on Xenia Avenue. This was came before the zoning office because the property owners, when they tore down an accessory structure, found that the survey pin was underneath it. They had believed that part of the alley would have been a part of their residence for over 25 years. They have full compliance with their neighbors on both sides. One has done a quit claim deed and the other is selling off a little portion. At the end, when this is all said and done, we'll have three lots in that area of town that are all conforming where they need to be. So.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions or comments from council? This is a second reading. I will open the public hearing for citizen comment. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next one, 2016-26.
This is repealing Chapter 238, Treasurer of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting a new Chapter 238, Treasurer.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I see that Rachel isn't here.
Melissa.
Melissa? Mm-hmm.
Basically, what Rachel had done was she had taken a look at the ordinance regarding our investments. It hadn't been updated in quite some time, and she basically just made it conform to Ohio Revised Code. So there weren't really any real notable changes other than just making it match Ohio Revised Code. There were some investments that weren't a part of the resolution or a part of the ordinance that needed to be included, such as Star Plus, which we had already been a part of. So it was just basically just bringing this up to present day per Ohio Revised Code. So that's
okay.
It.
That does remind me, though, that there was a pretty significant part of her treasurer's report that she submitted that was part of our consent agenda, where she was talking about the moving $2.25 million out of the U.S. Bank into Huntington. Melissa, could you explain that and talk about what the benefits will be?
Basically, we had all of our money sitting, well, the bulk of our reserves sitting in our U.S. Bank various accounts. We had some money put in Star Plus, which is now in Star Ohio, which was recently moved. So the one particular account, which was the municipal investor account, which is where a lot of our state taxes come in, that money just gets deposited into that account every single month, and we've never needed to tap into it. So basically, having more money with U.S. Bank was giving us earnings credits, which basically made our service charges with the bank go down, or it would offset them. So our service charges with the bank are roughly about $2,500 or so, and on a monthly basis we'd spend anywhere between $200 and $400 based on those earnings credits because of how much money we had. So the thought was that the money could work harder for us if we put it somewhere else and invested it. So what we did was we had selected Huntington Bank as an investment bank in order to put some of the money in. And the way that we set it up was every three months some of the money will mature. So we're able to make decisions based on a three-month basis whether or not we need it or we want to reinvest it. So I think the farthest one out is 2.5 years.
I didn't
from the beginning, or maybe 2 years.
I thought it was a year and a half, but it's tiered.
So, I mean, we haven't had to touch the money since I've been here out of that account, and the returns are much, much better than what they were based off of what we were getting from the earnings credit. So,
that's but we'll end up actually doing this, even though we will have higher service charges to U.S. Bank because we're not getting all the credits. The additional interest that we're going to be receiving from the Huntington account will actually net us, you believe, around $14,000 annually.
Mm-hmm. That was the estimate that was proposed to us.
Right, and we went through that because it was a directive from council at the end of, I think, the first quarter that we look at trying to invest the monies in a more appropriate manner, right, to increase the revenues.
And while it may not directly be connected to this piece of legislation, I did want to point it out and appreciate staff and our treasurer for doing that. It's every little bit helps.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Any other comments or questions from council? This is a public hearing. I will open the floor for comments from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, McQueen.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes. Just keep going on. I don't think we need to read the budget in full, do you?
Mm-mm.
Okay, go ahead.
So this is approving the 2017 annual appropriations and declaring an emergency at Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
And just to clarify on the emergency language in this ordinance, we have had two readings, but we needed it to be an emergency because so that it could be go into effect within sooner than 30 days, the 30 days that's typically required. So, Melissa, I see some very colorful pie charts, and I expect that the numbers haven't changed, but would you take a little bit of time to review the budget?
Yes, so this is the second reading of the annual appropriations for 2017. The only changes made to this ordinance format from the last time that we looked at it at the last meeting was the line under the general fund, which is section 2, was updated to say council commissions, which was changed. It used to read human relations commission, and we made that change to encompass all council commissions, so that line was updated with the new title or the new name. And the only other change that was made was the roll call at the bottom in the order in which that was in. So with the appropriations, total appropriations amount to $9,586,445, which is the lowest budget that I've had the privilege of creating since I've been here. I think this is my third, maybe. So along with the ordinance are all of the budget documents that have the detail that the ordinance ties into that we've all seen before. And then per council's request, there are a few pie charts attached to the budget at the end. What we have on the first page are the expenditures by fund, where you can see where the majority of our money is spent. And so it's 56% enterprise funds, followed by 32% general fund, 11% special revenue, and capital project funds are at 1%. And then to take a look at where most of our revenues come from, I included a pie chart for general fund revenues because the enterprise fund revenues are obviously all driven by consumer fees. So this shows that the majority of our revenues are a result of our income taxes that are brought in, followed by our real estate taxes, and then there are some other small things. As you can see, the state taxes that we receive are a very small portion, which have dwindled down over the years. So the income tax and the real estate taxes are our real revenue drivers for the general fund. Second page is our general fund budget by department. So you can see how those are broken down. The transfers is a large portion. It takes up the second largest slice of that pie. And the transfers are the monies that are transferred out to streets and parks and some of our capital improvement funds, because those funds on their own do not generate enough revenue in order to be able to support themselves. So that explains the transfers. The other ones are all pretty self-explanatory by department. And then the final pie chart is the enterprise funds and their expenditures by percentage of the total of all of the enterprise fund budgets that you'll see on the ordinance page and the following budget pages. So kind of shows where the money goes and where the money comes from. So I'll entertain any questions.
Any questions?
No. The pie charts are very helpful. Thank you.
You're welcome. Should have had them in the last one, but
yeah,
it slipped past me.
Yeah. Again, great work this year, getting the budget down and preparing and submitting great documents, and easily it becomes easier and easier every year. So we really appreciate it. This is the second reading and a public hearing. I will open the floor for comments from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy?
Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes.
Okay. Then we go to 2016-28. This is repealing section 242.01 composition classification of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 242.01 composition classification.
Okay. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty?
This is the ordinance we've been talking about, that currently our administrative code says there can be one captain and two sergeants in the police department. We would like to change that to allowing for three sergeants and the possibility of a captain later. So we need it to be three supervisors. This simply changes it from being specifically a captain and two sergeants to allowing the possibility of it being three sergeants instead of a captain and two sergeants.
Okay. Any questions from council? This is the second reading. I will open the floor for comments from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes.
Onward to ordinance 2016-29. This is repealing section 252.01 personnel classification of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 252.01 personnel classification.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty?
The same administrative code, just another portion of it, says that sergeants are to be paid a 3% premium above the highest paid regular rate of pay for road patrol officers. However, Chief has decided that as opposed to adding a 10th full-time officer, we will stay at 9 full-time officers, and he would like to increase the premium paid to a sergeant to be 8% above the highest road patrol officer, and that for a captain, should we ever need one, to be 8% above what the sergeants receive. Chief feels this is a more equitable solution, and at the same time, the fact that we're not adding that 10th full-time officer, this we're still saving approximately, was it $78,000 a year?
And I, something that wasn't asked, I assume this is in line, you know, the equity, I definitely agree with the increased workload, but this is in line with other communities and other jurisdictions?
Most jurisdictions are 10 to 16%.
For differential.
Right. If you make it splits between my pay, top patrol officer pay, two steps in the middle, 8% works very nice.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Thank you. Any other comments or questions from council? I will open the floor to comments or questions from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, McQueen.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes.
Next is Ordinance 2016-30. This is authorizing the funding of a part-time station manager position for the Community Access Channel of Yellow Springs.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Well, this one's pretty easy. I get Patty. Go ahead. Just by, it is a personnel issue, so you go ahead and talk about it.
Okay. Some of the Susan, as you know, is currently a contract employee. She's an independent contractor with the village. Some of the laws have changed a little bit, and we need to make Susan a part-time employee of the village, and so this ordinance does that. She will be performing exactly the same duties at the same pay. She will just be a part-time employee of the village as opposed to a contract employee.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments or questions from council? I will open the public hearing for comments or questions from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes.
Thank you. Susan is chomping at the bit.
Next is Ordinance 2016-31. This is repealing Section 1248.03 spatial requirements of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Section 1248.03 spatial requirements.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
And our planner, Denise Swinger, is here.
Hello. Previously, the low density requirement in the code was 10 each side. With the change in the zoning code, it somehow reflected a change to a minimum of 10 on one side and 15 feet on the other side, which basically put a lot of properties in residential A, low density, non-compliant. Planning Commission recognized this and agreed this was an error in the code, and so they approved to have it go back to what it was before, which is 10 feet on both sides.
Okay. Any comments or questions from council? I will open the floor for the public hearing. Any comments or questions from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, McQueen.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Wintrow.
Yes.
All right, this brings us to 2016-32. This is repealing Section 1224.01 application fee of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Section 1224.01 application fee.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
This is simply a housekeeping issue. There was, when the zoning code was updated, there was a fee structure that was updated. I think that was actually in 2015. Mm-hmm. However, at that time in 2015, when the fee schedule was updated, it wasn't noticed that there was a mention of right-of-way vacation procedure application fees in the planning section of the code as well. And so we, Planning Commission recognized that as well. We cleaned it up and have kept that as just a fee as established by council. So in the future, we only need to update the actual fee schedule rather than having to go back and change the fees in all these other sections of the code.
Okay, any comments or questions from council? I'll open the public hearing for comments or questions from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
While we're on planning, something I should have announced or asked Brian to announce earlier is that the Planning and Zoning Office will be closed for most of the month of December as Denise takes some well-deserved vacation from all of her duties here. I think she has a, do you have a conditional or variance hearing on Monday, Denise?
The 28th, yes.
Yeah, and so after that, I think that will be her hanging around for another week and then taking off for most of the month of December. So I will be processing the run-of-the-mill permits if needed, but anything large will wait for Denise to come back the first of the year.
Okay. Have a nice trip, Denise. I think this next one, Marianne, would you like that to be read in full? Would you, Judy, do you want to read it? Would you like to read it, Marianne?
Well, I can read the title. Okay.
Well, no, I mean, but do you want to read, do we want to have Judy read the whole thing in full?
The whole thing.
The resolution.
Yeah, yeah, I guess so.
I mean, I think it's pretty important.
Yeah.
Okay, let's just read that one in full.
Sure. This is Resolution 2016-57, recognizing that observance of Columbus Day is antithetical to the humanitarian values of the village, and replacing the observance of Columbus Day on the second Monday in October with the observance of Indigenous Peoples Day. Whereas Council for the Village of Yellow Springs recognizes that Yellow Springs and its environs are located upon the homelands and traditional use areas of the Shawnee, and that Glen Helen includes a burial mound of the Middle and Late Woodlands peoples who lived here from 500 BCE to 1500 AD, and whereas Village Council wishes to appreciate and support the work of the Miami Valley Council for Native Americans, who strive to, quote, preserve and promote the American Indian culture, its heritage, and its religion, and whereas Indigenous Peoples Day was first proposed in 1977 by a delegation of Native Nations to the United Nations, sponsored International Conference on Discrimination Against Indigenous Populations in the Americas, and whereas President Obama endorsed the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, the Declaration, on December 16, 2010, and the Declaration recognizes that Indigenous peoples have suffered from historic injustices as a result of, among other reasons, their colonization and dispossession of their lands, territories, and resources. And whereas Article 15 of the Declaration recognizes the right of Indigenous peoples to the dignity and diversity of their cultures, traditions, histories, and aspirations, which shall be appropriately reflected in education and public information, and places an obligation on states to take effective measures in consultation and cooperation with the Indigenous peoples concerned to combat prejudice and eliminate discrimination, and to promote tolerance, understanding, and good relations among Indigenous people and all other segments of society. Whereas Village Council shares a responsibility to oppose the existing systemic racism towards Indigenous peoples of the United States, now therefore be it resolved that, Section 1, Indigenous Peoples Day shall be used as a day to reflect upon the ongoing struggles of Indigenous peoples in this land and to celebrate the cultures and value of Indigenous peoples to this land. Section 2, Council for the Village of Yellow Springs encourages businesses, organizations, and public and educational institutions to recognize Indigenous Peoples Day.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. This is excellent work. Marianne, I know that that you and the Human Relations Commission has been working on it.
Yeah.
Would you?
Yeah. You know, I don't remember exactly. I think, I don't know if it was Lori Askelin. Someone recommended to HRC maybe a year ago that we consider doing this. And during that time, there have been discussions at HRC. I've talked to several people with roots in Indigenous societies, including Raymond Ruka, who lives in town, Guy Jones, who's with the Native American Council, and Summer McGuire, who presented at our last council meeting. And all three of those people, conversations with them influenced this resolution. Also, Scott Sanders made a contribution. Scott Sanders, the archivist at Antioch mm-hmm. College. And I definitely want to acknowledge Judy, at the end of the table, who came up with really the recognizing that first sentence, as well as contributed to the organization of the resolution and fact-checked some of, and made some important changes. So, so this has had a number of people involved. The resolution itself is based pretty much on Portland, Oregon, and just adapted it to fit Yellow Springs with their permission. So we feel good about this, at least as a first step.
And do you know how widespread this legislation is across the country?
Well, when I looked online, there were maybe a half a dozen cities that popped up as having the resolution. I'm not aware of any place in Ohio. I didn't find any place in Ohio, anyway. There may be. I didn't find it.
Cincinnati rather notoriously
passed
their resolution.
Correct. The Miami Council was working with them, with Cincinnati, and I don't know why they didn't pass it, but they didn't. But we did. We are.
Well, we do.
We will.
Well, and I guess I also want to say I particularly like that the title emphasizes replacing Columbus Day. I think that was, you know, an important statement to make here.
And I think as it, there are groups that will be working on some educational programs. Is that my understanding?
Summer is very interested in doing that with the schools. Now, okay. Whether HRC will move forward or any other group, I don't know.
I think that would be great.
Set just the basis for that.
And I mean, I guess the only other thing we might think about is how we might address this and when Columbus Day. Now, Columbus Day isn't a recognized holiday. It isn't a day off for our staff. It is for some people. I mean, we might want to think about how what we want to do next Indigenous Peoples Day and how we want to introduce that and frame that to folks in this community. So maybe that's at least something that HRC can think about. So just making sure folks understand. I guess we should probably take a vote, though, first. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you all.
Are we doing this next?
The employment, yeah, we probably, can we hold off? Or
we can hold off, yeah.
Chris, can we? Yeah, we can. I think we can. The clerk's contract.
Yeah.
Well,
we can put it on the agenda.
Okay, thank you. We will do that because we didn't have all the information. And the next resolution, 2016-59, I would also like to read in full.
This is approving the annual distribution of flour and sugar. Whereas residents of Yellow Springs enjoy the benefits of Gaunt Park as a result of the generosity of Whelan Gaunt, and whereas as a condition of his gift, the aforesaid parkland to the village was that part of the earnings from use of that land be set aside to buy and distribute flour and sugar to the widows of the village, and whereas on November 19th, 2012, council voted to include widowers in this behest, and whereas as the holiday season approaches and we think of ways we can share our love and concern for all members of this community, it is fitting that we honor the memory of Whelan Gaunt and the spirit of his gift in the manner he intended. Now, therefore, council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, hereby resolves that. Section 1, the village manager is hereby authorized and directed to procure the traditional supplies and distribute them as stipulated in the deed for Gaunt Park and as expanded by council in 2012. Section 2, this expenditure of up to $3,000 from the Park's Widows Fund number 902-1703-54102 is hereby authorized as provided in the village's annual appropriations.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So this is always one of my favorite resolutions of the year, and why I always like to read it in full. And Brian did mention that if anyone is new to the list, we're sorry for that, but we also want you to let us know, let staff know, so that that you can get the flour and sugar. Mm-hmm. You could let us know by bringing us cookies if you'd like. But hopefully it's something that is appreciated, and I'm sure that it is. Any other comments or questions? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Let's just read this last one in full, too.
Okay. This is Resolution 2016-60, awarding a contract for construction of public improvements on the north side of Dayton Yellow Springs Road from East Enum Road to the entrance to the village-owned property formerly known as the Center for Business and Education. Whereas council has authorized the village manager to solicit proposals for the Dayton Yellow Springs infrastructure project, and whereas after distributing several sets of plans to prospective bidders and having received five bids, an apparent lowest and best bid has been identified, and whereas Majors Enterprises Pipeline has to date no unresolved findings for recovery on record, now therefore council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio does hereby resolve that, section one. The amount of the Majors Enterprises Incorporated bid is $247,482, and is therefore the lowest and best. Section two, the bid for construction of the above cited improvements is hereby awarded to Majors Enterprises Incorporated of Monroe, Ohio. Section three, the village manager is hereby authorized and directed to enter into a contract to construct the improvements as designed with Majors Enterprises Incorporated.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, great. So I think it was two meetings ago that we, after there's been a lot of discussion about this issue, hearing from citizens, and kind of deciding how we were going to move forward with discussing development at this, we'll come up with a name at some point, the CBE. I'm just going to say that it was decided that we would at least move forward with the infrastructure. We do have the grant from the Army Corps of Engineers that has been sitting. There is always a chance that that will be, that we will lose that. There is definitely support on council for this to move forward. So in order to keep the opportunity or the possibility that we could potentially see this construction begin in the 2016 season, or at least early in 2017, we wanted to move forward as quickly as possible. Patty or Melissa, do either of you want to add anything?
No, we had five bids, and as you can see from the range there, they varied greatly in price. Majors Enterprises is a relatively new company, but they had several very good references with other municipalities for similar projects, and so they need to be awarded this bid, and they say they're ready to go now.
That's great. That's great to hear. Any other comments or questions? I will open this the floor on this discussion to any citizen comments or questions. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you all. Done with all of that legislation. Next item on the agenda is citizens' concerns. It's where we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. We ask you to come to the podium and speak into the microphone, state your name, and you have 3 minutes for us to hear your comments. Okay. Oh, sir.
I'm not clear on what this is about. I got notice that there was a hearing tonight in regard to proposed construction on the corner of King Street and Dayton Street.
That's the one next Monday, correct?
That's the
28th. That's the
28th. Well, a week early.
Yes,
yep.
Yes, you are.
Well, we hope you enjoyed yourself.
Well, you know what? It is interesting. And I wanted to make a comment about the Indigenous Peoples Day.
Oh, sorry, I didn't ask.
It didn't
ask.
Seem like there was an opportunity to do that. I really wanted to say something.
Say it now.
The progressive consciousness of this community to enact such a thing, and it's very refreshing to hear what I would consider highly accurate U.S. history instead of the laundered stuff that we got in school. So I'd just like to say that, and it was nice showing up a week early. Now I've familiarized myself.
Well, you know what it looks like, that's going to be much less scary. So could you tell us your name?
Michael Wilson.
Okay, great. Thank you, Mr. Wilson.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Anyone else? Okay. We have no special reports. We have three items of old business. First is the Economic Sustainability Commission proposal for the CBE land discussion. I will turn that over to Brian.
Thank you. At the last Economic Sustainability Commission meeting, we discussed following, and I think I've referenced this before, the format that we used for the local policing forum. So the idea would be to have some questions that were citizens can respond to with boxes around town, also via SurveyMonkey. or in person. And really, I think the only thing left, we had already talked about partnering with Village Mediation, is to set a date. And we will have another Economic Sustainability Commission meeting on December 7th to do that.
And what, do you remember, I'm sure you do remember, what day of the week
We did a Thursday.
Okay. I mean, it seems that Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, obviously, I think would probably be the, you know, the date to consider. So, okay. Any other input?
Yeah. At the Village Mediation Program, we have discussed this, and two of the people on that steering committee are interested in helping with the planning of it, because I assume there's going to be some planning of it.
Yeah.
Right?
Sure.
So
that sounds great.
And both Lynn Kramer and Janet Mueller
great.
Would be interested in helping, and I don't know how we want to connect them with the commission. What do you suggest?
Yeah, I will invite them to the December 7th meeting.
Okay.
And there is a subcommittee working on it as well. So if they can't make it to that meeting, they can still connect with them. But that's great.
So it's the 7th?
Yeah.
December 7th. At
first 7. First Wednesday.
Up here in this room.
Yep.
At 7?
Yes.
Okay. Any other comments or questions from council? Any citizen comments or questions? Okay. So we will, I assume we'll learn more about this at the next. Well, no.
Yeah, unfortunately, you know, I mean, I had considered calling an emergency meeting, but I guess the reality is we won't really be able to do something, I think, until the beginning of the year
right.
with the holidays. So,
right.
But the, you know, but the format's established, so I think it's really just picking a date and planning and moving forward. So.
Okay. Thank you. Next item is a report on village-owned properties, and we had a great report, excuse me, an analysis submitted by Marianne and Jerry on this, working with Patty.
No, this is that was the sidewalk one. This is the village-owned properties list that Jerry and I counted.
Oh, that just Jerry. Okay,
yeah.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Okay, so Jerry and Patty worked on this.
Yeah.
So Jerry, do you want to handle it or have Patty handle it?
I was going to have Patty.
Council asked Jerry and myself earlier this year to create a list of all of the village-owned properties and what they're currently used for, how large they are, as much historical information that we could get, which that was the difficult part. You will see a list in there of all of the village-owned properties, their acreage, where they're located, and whether they're currently used for something. There is a small report with it, and the reason that the report is so small is because Jerry and I felt that this should be part of the larger discussion that is going on at the Planning Commission as far as the use of property within the village in general, and specifically about our properties. So to that end, we wanted to provide this to council per the earlier request, but also say that we felt it needed to be covered in by the Planning Commission as part of the comprehensive plan and the input mm-hmm. for that. Jerry, do you agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. The CBE isn't on here. Is the CBE?
Well, it was created before we did that because I was supposed to put it in the packet the last time, but like Melissa, it got away from me,
okay.
and I didn't send it to Judy in time. So, yes, you can add the CBE property on that, and I will do that before I send it to the Planning Commission.
And why is the Triangle Park unknown acreage?
Because it's not listed on the auditor's website acreage-wise.
What would it be, like 0.10
yeah.
acres or something?
Yeah,
0.1 acre, whoever.
Yeah.
Although, yeah, probably John Eastman would know what the acreage
yeah.
was. He could figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We're not going to.
Yeah, and some of the properties, for instance, Beatty Hughes was originally purchased through a HUD grant, so it had a restriction on it that it had to remain green space, but that restriction was actually lifted through a memo from HUD back in 1988. So that property can actually be used for something else now if we choose to.
I realize, you know, I know you're going to turn it over to Planning Commission for more work, but I would kind of like to see this list segmented into, clearly we're not doing anything with the mm-hmm. water treatment plant, you know,
right.
so that, you know, utility active is together.
Absolutely.
Properties that are being occupied, currently occupied, like this building,
the library,
Stony Creek Library, things like that. So segment it so that we can potentially see more readily what properties we could potentially be considering for other uses.
Okay, I can do that and put it in the next packet.
Thanks. Any other comments or questions?
And we did discuss that. But we felt that it should be a total council discussion and not us making recommendations.
And maybe have reason purchase if you know, but then have another category that says, you know, current status or something like that. Maybe okay. separate reason purchased from current status if we know, and I don't know.
Well, for example, Stony Creek, you know, the fact that it's going to be under lease for at least, you know, another couple
right.
of years and things like that.
I mean, it appears that we don't really have any knowledge about the reason purchased for most of this.
That's correct.
Right. And so maybe right. we should just eliminate it as a category. I actually think that Sutton Farm was purchased potentially, I guess it says green space, I think it was purchased to prevent development because there was a proposed development going out in that area, and I think that's why it was purchased.
We tried to get some historical perspective from some of the folks who have lived around the village for quite some time. Jerry was working on that, and he just didn't really have a lot of luck.
Okay.
So the consensus is to remove the reason purchased and add current use and potential future use, kind of?
I don't know if potential future use, but just if it's, you know, maybe have a couple of categories.
Present, we'll just put, was it, you know, if it's a park, now
present
it's a park.
Use,
yeah.
Right,
status,
yeah.
Current status.
Under lease until
right.
such and
right.
such.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, because if there is like a date like that, that would be mm-hmm. good to capture here.
You know, and certainly understanding the Board of Ed office, what that, and right. I think we all know that, but just iterating on there somewhere what that.
Yeah.
Relationship is. So, okay, great, good work, thanks. Okay, so next, the work that Mary Ann did and Jerry related to sidewalks. There was a great deal more information in the online packet than there was in our paper packets, which included a great deal of past work that had been done, reports from council and reports from Assistant Manager John Young about sidewalks. So I will turn it over to the two of you to explain your findings.
Mary Ann's supposed to be.
Okay. Well, I think council has been discussing how to manage our sidewalks for, well, as long as I've been on council, probably longer than that, 3 years. And during the last couple years, staff did a lot of work, especially when John Young was here, but also Jason Hamby, and I think maybe we had some interns,
mm-hmm.
did a lot of work in looking at the condition of all our sidewalks. So we have, from whatever that was, 1 or 2 years ago, the condition of all the sidewalks in the village. John Young looked at options for funding who should pay for sidewalks. Should it be the village sidewalk repair replacement? Should it be the village? Should it be the property owner? And he did research in different communities where it's one or the other or both. All of this information has come to council in the past. We discussed how aggressively to pursue sidewalk repair replacement, and John or Jason, one or both of them, had a cost for total sidewalk replacement in the village, which was not cheap. We also talked about the possibility of having a levy, if we were going to do major sidewalk repair, replacement, of actually putting it on the ballot. So things have sort of gone along. I think it was really at the beginning of this year when sidewalks was up as maybe one of our goals to make a decision about that Jerry and I ended up being the people that said we make a report. So we got together, and as you can see from this one-page report, we are more or less recommending the status quo. We're recommending not to engage in a major overhaul of our sidewalks, and therefore not recommending not to put something on the ballot regarding that. And the main reason, and I'm speaking, I'll let Jerry speak for himself. Certainly cost is a big issue. I mean, to totally repair all of our sidewalks would be a very major expense, and you know, times we just don't have a lot of money lying around. For me, though, as someone who walks and cycles, while I recognize that we do have some sidewalks that need repair, especially I think for people with some mobility issues, on the whole, it's fairly easy to walk around the village. Walk on a sidewalk, can walk on the road in a lot of cases, and so given sort of balancing the cost with how accessible we already are, I think we came down on saying let's pretty much keep the system we have. The system we have is that the village government pays for sidewalk repairs. We've noted some exceptions in this report, and I'll mention that. We have, I think it's $50,000 a year as an automatic fund for repairing sidewalks, and that should go toward the sidewalks that, whether it's citizens and or the village recommend need repair, that money goes toward those repairs. The exceptions to the village funding the sidewalks, as our recommendation, are if a private resident or business wants to repair their sidewalk, that would be great. We're not going to stand in their way.
But they have to do it to code. They have to do it to our standards.
They have to do it to code. Good. Then that doesn't say anything about that in here. So that would be important. Also, there are cases clearly where property owners or their agents have created the problems. For example, big trucks driving up and down over the sidewalk. And in those cases, we are suggesting that those property owners be responsible, that the village hold those property owners to be responsible for those repairs. And then when there's a development going to be done, whatever the zoning code says about sidewalks, either the sidewalks are going to get put in by the developer or they're not needed, but that they not be just put in piecemeal and not connect to anywhere. They actually connect to existing sidewalks. And then there are some cases where the government, and maybe in collaboration with property owners, agree that there's an area where we need to have good sidewalks. And that would be beyond $50,000 a year. So in those cases, there may be some places where property owners will be willing, they're interested enough in having sidewalk that they'd work with the village to collaborate on that. There may be situations where the village itself feels like it's important to have a major sidewalk repair in a certain area, and that should be specially funded. I mean, that council would agree to that would be, those funds would be specially set aside. A couple other recommendations are if there are sidewalks on both sides of the street, and repairs are needed, we only feel that only one side actually needs to be repaired. That sometimes sidewalks on both sides are redundant, other than maybe Dayton Street, Xenia Avenue, those two major streets. the concept of a complete street policy, and we were given information by that from MVRCP, is something that we felt should be considered wherever possible. And lastly, and this is a new recommendation, regarding clearing sidewalks in the winter. Now, we've always held that property owners are supposed to clear their sidewalks. But downtown, that's not really possible for downtown businesses. And there's an accumulation of snow that can happen when the crews or whoever comes through dumps, the snow gets dumped on the edge of the sidewalk. Property or businesses may dump snow to the edge, and then we get these big piles. And that is a difficulty for seniors and for people with mobility issues. And we are recommending that when that height of those snow piles gets to be a certain amount, that the village take responsibility for clearing those snow piles.
But you're not saying, what you said initially was a little confusing. You're not saying, you're still saying that those business owners or property owners need to clear their sidewalks.
Yeah, but what results?
But, right, I understand. Yeah. But the way you initially started it made it sound like you said it was difficult for them to do, but they still have to do it.
Yeah, they can't.
They will get some assistance.
They can't
with the
remove the snow from the sidewalk as other areas in the village can.
I've got a few other questions.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, a couple clarifications also. in terms of where there are sidewalks on both sides of the street in one area, it may appear that the sidewalk dead ends into nowhere, but on the other side, it continues on down to the end of the street. We're saying not to take that dead end sidewalk and run it down. People can cross over.
And that was one of the clarifications. I kind of disagree with what Mary Ann said. I think I don't care if there are sidewalks on both sides of the street. If there is damaged sidewalk, if there is existing damaged sidewalk, I think existing damaged sidewalk needs to be replaced.
Right.
Or removed.
Right.
Or removed. Something, yes. I don't think we should.
Yeah, that one was strictly talking about where there were sidewalks on both sides of the street. And one may have stopped.
Okay.
And then the other one continues on.
Okay.
And we have a number of those.
Right.
Where you can cross the street safely from what we observed and continue on the sidewalk.
Okay. Are you done, Jerry?
Let's see.
The point C needs to actually relate to new construction.
New construction. Mm-hmm.
Because there could be infill, which would be a single property owner.
New construction.
And I think that also needs to be clarification related to developments like Birch 3,
correct,
where there is a single developer that could possibly walk away. There's an agreement, a resident agreement,
homeowners
association.
Yes.
We need to make sure that they're responsible, that we do not install brand new sidewalks.
Correct.
Well, the first thing is that the planning code does not, zoning code does not currently, I believe, require them to do it until they build on that lot.
Right, exactly.
So if one of the things is that we want them to put in all of the sidewalks in a subdivision at the same time, that needs to be changed in the code.
That doesn't make sense.
Correct. And I don't know many developers who are going to want to do that. So that's the first thing. Do you have something else? Because I have something.
No.
Since we're talking about developers, I mean, one of John Young's recommendations was that we include a fee in lieu if we don't feel there's a need for sidewalks. So it seems like there is some work to do with our ordinance.
But I think that maybe goes back to, that's true. I mean,
I don't think we have that right now.
No.
But
well, I think all new, it does say that all new developments should require sidewalks.
Yes.
Yes.
But we don't have the fee in lieu.
Right, but I don't know.
Well, we should at least look at it.
Yeah, because I would want to be very careful about saying that sidewalks aren't, thinking about sidewalks not being required if
it's something that, so we'll talk about it, we'll talk about that.
And I did have one thing, if everyone's, as far as the removal of the piles from downtown, the first thing I'd like to say is that the crews do, even though we don't plow downtown, because that's, well, we do Dayton Street, but we don't do Xenia, because ODOT does it. But we do, when the crews, as soon as they get a chance, they go down there and they shovel so that the handicap ramps are clear, and especially the one in front of the senior center where there's a parking space. And, you know, they make sure that those things are clear. And as far as removing the piles from downtown, I guess my question would be, at what point do you see that being necessary? Because that is a very labor-intensive job. And if it's, you know, we can't, I don't think it would be feasible for us to do it for just a few feet of snow, right. But I can understand where if it gets...
We're talking about a major...
Right, and that's something they do anyway. Right.
And it, you know, when it ices is a huge issue.
Because the issue you have is that once the snow piles up, we clean it out in front of the senior center. Okay, now you're asking folks when they get out of the car to walk down the street to the next cleared area. And but for the seniors, that could be a problem.
I think that there's also things that maybe Jason could do, and maybe, you know, we could have, the chamber could help facilitate a meeting. I know we've talked about it in past years. Asking people to pile the snow at the tree on the tree lawns, that will take care of a lot of it. Mm-hmm. If they don't just shove it right in front of the curb.
Right, and there are more trees now.
And they're bigger.
And they're bigger.
And so if even that's something that a couple of village guys could make sure is done. Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of just doing a little bit of shoveling, but I think that would almost take care of it.
We thought about that, but then again, not knowing what, you know, because the county does Xenia Avenue.
No, the state.
The state.
Yeah.
We don't.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we do, but we don't. But anyway, the what damage the piling of the snow might do to the trees. And you don't know until you do it.
All right. I don't think it's going to get high enough. I just think it's a good place to...
Well...
It depends on how cold it stays, to be honest with you. If it stays cold and the snow doesn't melt, it could conceivably get high if it continues to...
Right.
I mean, it's something that we could try and just monitor and see how much snowfall we get.
Yeah. But we didn't want to say that, you know, because, you know, we love our trees.
Yeah. But I will. I can talk to Jason about that and see what he has to say.
So, yeah, I'd like to hear other comments regarding our main proposal that we not do a major.
Well, I guess I wanted to start out by, you know, in reviewing the materials again. You know, I'm looking at the ranking that John did, and I remember challenging that ranking based on the assumptions, but it did put status quo at well below the other options, funding repair, returning responsibility. And I guess I just wondered what you guys were focused on to sort of rank differently from this.
Budget and you know, total cost of the village, assuming repair of all the sidewalks,
mm-hmm.
and so forth. And Mary Ann probably did a more detailed tour of the village than I did, looking at sidewalks, and it was her opinion that, you know, they did not require a major repair, because and then what I looked at was connectability in terms of sections of sidewalks, and they were on the non-major thoroughfares, the more residential areas, people could easily cross over to the other sidewalks over there. And it appears that, and I don't know if the village crew did it or not, a lot of the sidewalks that were in bad need of repair have been marked. Did Jason do that, or?
Jason has marked some of them, not necessarily for repair, but for, to alert people. Or to know where he has to go and grind them down.
So we are doing grinding?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so looking at that, to me at least, it seemed like it was solving a lot of our, problems of the uneven sidewalks and so forth. You know, I just, in other than, what is it, over on the south end of town?
Mercer Court.
Mercer Court, you know, which is a disaster, but.
But those sidewalks could probably, that's an area that we, that there probably shouldn't have been sidewalks, other than the fact that of the connectivity that was already going on Southview.
Right, and the residents there are actually evenly split, because I still have in my file the letters from the residents that when Kent Bristol did the survey right before I came on board when he was interim. I still have the, and they're 50-50, that some of them want the sidewalks and half of them don't.
But then we have the example of the letter.
I would like Judy to read that letter because of the conversation she's been having with.
Right.
Sure, this came about because this resident stopped Jason Hamby and had a conversation with him, and then he passed along her number. So I've sort of written out our conversation a little bit. Resident Christine Johnson uses a power chair to traverse between her home on Dayton Street and town, and she's spoken with both Jason and myself about the lack of accessibility to wheelchair travel along that street. She asked that this information be conveyed to you as you discuss bike paths, sidewalks, and options for those routes. She first indicated her willingness to assist the village in strategically planning the bike lane along Dayton Street. She noted she's a trained assessor for accessible sidewalks as well as a user of those sidewalks, and she hopes she can help in an improvement in the accessible routes. She informed me that she's forced into the street at a number of points along her route to town due to either severe heaving and cracking of the pavement, often because of tree roots, or to lack of or improper curb cuts. She notes that due to the nature of her condition, the many bumps and cracks, while not impossible to surmount, are painful for her, and some of them are insurmountable. She commented that she likes the idea of asphalt as a surface because it presents a smoother ride and because it tends to heave less. She also commented that any push buttons for crosswalks should be placed at wheelchair height, and that in general, crossing or riding along or in Dayton Street is a dangerous experience. And she is planning to watch the meeting, and I told her I would follow up with her again tomorrow and have another conversation.
Well, this seems like an example of what we need. Citizens coming to the village saying, this is a problem. And clearly, Dayton Street is a major route.
Right. You know, we've identified the safe routes to school, and it's not every street. You know, we're not concentrating on every sidewalk, every street. We're concentrating on the main thoroughfares to school, and just as, you know, for the village, it should be the main thoroughfares into town, into the central business district. So, it does seem like Dayton Street has some significant issues and has maybe not been addressed as well as Xenia Avenue has, you know, gotten great attention. Rightly so, because of Friends Care Center and because it is obviously a major route.
And so related to that, I think that, competing priorities with the budgetary one is this accessibility piece. I've got some concerns about Dayton and other places. But also, we have talked about the legal liability issues. And Chris, I don't know if anything new has come up in this area. I mean, it's been at least a year since we talked about it last time. And I remember the reports we got implied that there was a potential for there to be some issues. So, and I'm not saying we have to discuss that tonight, but I think that as we develop this and discuss it a little bit more, I think we need to make sure that we properly have thought those out. So
that's why we brought the report to council.
Yeah. I think this is a good place to.
It gives us a starting point.
Right.
And I don't know who would do this. I think that, you know, it would be good. Melissa and Denise did a great job going to Greene County to get the CDBG grant for the sidewalk, for the crosswalks, the ramps, the handicap ramps. We're getting a significant number in the coming years, so that's good. I mean, and those are important because it's, you know, frustrating to have a great sidewalk, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden you can't, you get to the end of the sidewalk and you can't cross the street anyway, mm-hmm. so. As many grant opportunities as possible.
Right, and I wanted to ask, do we have dedicated funding for sidewalks in the budget for 2017?
We have the same $50,000.
Well,
that we have.
I mean, actually, we did not have it in. We did not technically have it in the budget last year, so.
We did not have anything specifically earmarked because that would have came out of professional services. So.
Right.
Unless it was put in there and not used, but I don't. I think that it was used for other things and not used for sidewalks.
So because we partly held off on it because we were going to investigate this.
But wait a minute. We did a lot of sidewalk work last year. How much did we spend on sidewalks in 2018?
Well, in addition to streetscape, we made the front ramp out here, coming down from the bike path. We redid that to make it. We decreased the angle so a wheelchair can come down that. We also went up Dayton Street, or Xenia Avenue, repairing that sidewalk and making the larger spaces to make the, so that the wheelchairs could pass each other. So in addition to what we did on Xenia, we did those projects with the $50,000 as well. And then we did over by the Wen's wine shop over there on Quarry, where there was that big heave due to the tree root. We mm-hmm. repaired that and a couple of other small places. I mean, $50,000 sounds like a lot, but it doesn't go far when you're starting to talk about concrete. So when we did all these little here and there projects with it last year.
And what, how much did we spend on the streetscape?
I don't remember all the time.
Okay, just on the sidewalk piece of the streetscape.
But the confusion is, and again, if you look at the documentation, I mean, there's a clear statement that we did not dedicate that money last year to sidewalks. I'm not saying we didn't spend it, but, you know, what I'm raising here is that if we are making this status quo commitment, that's clear and that's in Jason's plan.
Okay, so what you're saying is that you'd like to see that be a specific line in the budget to delineate it?
It's just that it's available.
I think that what could happen is, I mean, it comes out of professional services because it's a contractor that we pay to do it. I think that really what should probably be done, just for transparency on all fronts, is that a plan is submitted at the beginning of the year. These are the areas that we intend to fix this year, and this is the approximate cost of what concrete's going for in 2017, and this is the plan. And then it could be a discussion, you know, because maybe there's another area of town that could be, you know, perceived as worse and should be subbed out for something that's proposed, and it just be a continuing ongoing discussion because, I mean, the sidewalks are continuing to deteriorate.
That wouldn't happen if you guys came to us saying, you know, these are the sidewalks we need to
right.
You know, we would assume that you're picking the worst cases to, you know.
Well, I mean, it'd be presented to council that way citizens right. have a chance to have input too.
Yeah.
If there's disagreement in a certain area of town and there's considered to be a maybe higher priority somewhere else.
But I would think as part of your plan, mm-hmm. you would be talking to the citizens in the area anyway.
Right.
Which is, mm-hmm. we've done it in the past, like you said, Kent went over and maybe got a 50-50, but we got a serious issue. I think both our staff and the citizens both recognize that.
I just
and
think
it shouldn't, be, versus trying to say we're going to put this dollar amount every year in the sidewalks, you know, that might not be feasible. But I think a plan or a statement by council that says, you know, we are going to do yearly sidewalk maintenance or replacement based upon staff recommendations.
And then I agree with Melissa. I think those recommendations, you know, being in the packet so that citizens can weigh in
that's what I'm saying.
Would be good.
Right. And
yep.
we can do that. I mean, normally Jason has a list of what he's going to do. We can just present it in the packet so that it's out there and everyone knows what we're going to do that year. That's.
Have we connected sidewalk work to the streets that we're, to the street paving and to other infrastructure?
Generally, we only do that if we're going to damage the sidewalk doing the construction. If we're digging it up to put a water line underneath it or a sewer line or something like that, then we'll put it back. Generally, when we do street paving, we don't really do too many big street reconstructions here. So we're not digging up the entire street. But if it's something that we damage in the course of doing a project, then yes, we put it back. But it's not, generally our program here is that we just do the sidewalk and fix the sidewalk, so.
I mean, something else I don't really want to get into a big discussion tonight, but at the last meeting, Sergeant Watson, thank you. I cannot remember her new name. Sergeant Watson and Jason Hamby presented about the little asphalt bike trails. I believe that the Active Transportation Committee is going to be talking about that. So I really don't want to talk about that specifically, but it was brought up by Judith and then by the woman who wrote the letter who talked to Judy, this idea of asphalt in lieu of concrete. I'm having a hard time wrapping my head around that, exactly how that works. I mean, you can't just dump down a little 5-foot section of asphalt. I mean, so I think it's not as easy as it sounds. It doesn't make me real comfortable just because aesthetically, I don't like it. Maybe in some situations it is more functional. There may be other materials that are more like concrete that would work better. So that's probably something, again, that should be considered and talked about.
But along with that, area that Jason was talking about up West South College from Xenia Avenue up to the high school, we do have individuals now that are handicapped and are in wheelchairs, and they're trying to traverse from Xenia Avenue up to the high school. One individual is attempting to use the paved path because the sidewalk is really impassable for his wheelchair.
Again, is it trees? Is it
it's just
branches?
It's more of this, the breaks in the sidewalk.
But it's probably coming from tree roots.
The sidewalks just haven't been. See, the sidewalk going up West South College is well, if you're heading, let's say if you're heading west, is on the right side of where the major trees are, and the trees are more growing toward the bike path, but the sidewalk is uneven. But he's able to go down the asphalt portion of it. The only issue is that his partner who's with him, there's not enough space for her to be beside him. So it's a constant. My suggestion, if we are able some way to make that a smooth path like the streets were, that would give him the ability to go back and forth to school like the other kids. His companion can walk on that sidewalk because it is walkable, but it's just her in the wheelchair, so she would then be able to stay beside him as they go up. But I'm not suggesting that we either widen the sidewalks or widen the path, but that would give him that option.
Yeah.
Because a wheelchair is not a bicycle, and you don't want a wheelchair in the street. I don't think it's in the street. But, so that was my other concern, about safety, getting the kids back and forth to school and so forth. But I think that's something, and as Jason said before, it's already ADA compliant because the bike path goes down and then meets flush with the street.
I don't, if it doesn't have, it's, I would say it's accessible.
The only thing it doesn't have is the little ripple, red thing in it. But in other words, we wouldn't have to do a major tear up there to accommodate it. We're probably going to have more handicapped children in wheelchairs wanting to exercise.
Well, the thing about asphalt is that it's a continuous path. It's not done in sections like concrete. Therefore, the opportunity for it to heave is a little bit less because it doesn't have forces coming up. It cracks in it.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And I also think, Jerry, besides thinking about accommodations for, you know, future students, is thinking about accommodations for our aging in place population. And so, I do want to kind of think about, you know, what Yellow Springs is going to look like moving forward. I do think the Active Transportation Committee is, you know, this is, we've talked about getting them engaged, and they are supposed to meet on Monday. And I like the idea of formalizing that relationship so we can get more advice from them.
But I don't mean interrupt you, but, you know, I'm more concerned about this, the child on the wheelchair.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a tendency to keep pushing things out. You know, my thing is this kid, if we have a decent path, has the opportunity to enjoy education as his peers do, versus having to be stuck on a handicapped bus daily when he rides by and see his friends laughing, talking, walking, and so forth, and he's sitting there in the back of the bus. Yeah, I understand turning over to a committee, but you know, to me, I feel that, you know, providing the handicapped access to the student so he'll have 4 years of enjoyable, he's in the seventh grade, so he'll have that same type of experience that his peers are having.
Well, I think of their role is different. If we've identified a problem that we need to fix, then we get the advice on how to do that the right way, cost effectively. And, you know, that was one thing. I was actually at the Complete Streets conference last week, and that was something that was really highlighted, is focusing on what are the problems you need to fix. And we've talked about some, right? We've talked about Dayton Street. We've talked about West South College. So let's start there. So I'm not suggesting, let's go into 5 years of planning. But let's.
I want that clarification.
Right.
Yeah,
I think that's good.
So we want these as priorities.
Yes.
Well, and can I just throw something in? I had several conversations with Jason Hamby and then with Sergeant Watson about that discussion. And there's general agreement from those folks who watch kids traversing that route and me who has one of them doing it, that there's a big gap between the ideal with sharrows and folks sharing the road and people who are actually commuting on their bikes to, good Lord, half those kids are wearing half a shoe, eating a piece of toast, and talking to their friend. It's not the same. That bike ride is not the same as it is for an adult who's commuting at all. And as a parent, I would far rather have them up on a sidewalk with their piece of toast and their one shoe than in a road trying to follow arrows and traffic. That's just reality as to who's using that spot. And That's just my two cents as it goes off, because I just think there's a gap in the discussion between kind of who's using it and an ideal transportation system.
And it is a bicycle is transportation, just like a car is. And we don't let a kid in a car to drive without lessons. I think the whole education piece is completely being ignored. Nobody's taking responsibility for it. It's one of the five E's with the Complete Streets. Nobody is talking about education, and I understand I had one of those kids too, but the parents and the kids and the teachers and the principals do need to take some responsibility for educating them as to how to get to school, how to ride that bike, how to, what the rules are, what the laws are.
Right.
We've got to take that responsibility. Who would put their kid out in what is essentially a lethal weapon? You know, do you not tell them to look to cross the street when they're walking? Why wouldn't you tell them the rules of the road?
Right, and I know that the chief and the PD do some bicycle safety with some of the younger kids, but I don't think that the older kids have been as receptive, if I'm correct.
That's because nobody's requiring it.
We've actually had Tim Kerr and I have, and Chief, we have exchanged some emails about that education piece, and a few ideas have come up around how to do that and how to make some improvements in that safety picture. So it hasn't gone ignored. I think kind of the problem in a way is, where can we direct these kids? If we haven't got that bike path piece, I mean, I think it needs to coordinate a little bit, and everyone's sort of waiting for that other piece to kind of fall in. Where do we go? I don't know that anyone's deliberately being delinquent about it, and that is a very hard group to reach. But I'm certainly willing to keep, you know, the email stuff going in with you guys regarding safety, and I know that PD's has it on the radar.
Well, and we've got folks like Dan Kerrigan who sounds like he'd be happy to be out there and redirect kids when needed.
Physically.
But I think we have other people too.
Yeah, I mean, and when it comes to those bike trails, there's a big difference between the one estimate of around $9,000 and the other of $50,000 or more to fix that asphalt. And I don't want to just throw $50,000 or more money at something if it's not a good investment.
Right.
$9,000, you know, I can do a temporary kind of a fix for that. But, you know, so is Jason working on checking with Greene County? And,
yeah, he was. Okay. Yeah, and I actually wrote myself a note here to follow up with him for the next meeting on that. So.
Well, I think we should be talking about this again on December 5th. I think we should start to move towards what these priorities are. What are the key problems that we agree we need to fix? Sounds like we've got a couple, and we tackle those. And that's what, you know, we keep doing that. I mean, with the status quo, how do we maximize those dollars to start solving some of these problems?
Have we decided that we're all willing to not change the financial requirement that we're asking of homeowners? That would resolve a big part of this and not cost the village money.
Are we talking about sidewalks now?
Yes. So
now the policy we have in place says what?
That we pay for all of it. So, I mean, that's certainly an option. An option is for us to put the responsibility back on the homeowners, either in full or in part. Maybe it's a partial.
Right, supporting the fixing.
Right. So, you know, I'm not ready to take that totally off the table.
No.
This report to address the financial? You're not even, you know, interested in discussing financial responsibility of homeowners potentially?
Oh, well, I mean, I'm speaking for myself. I think that the responsibility should stay with the village, with the exceptions listed. I mean, and we used to, I understand, have it be with the homeowners and not much happened, which I guess, which is probably why the village took it over.
It's also because there was no mechanism in place to enforce. Require or enforce that the sidewalks be replaced, which is why they got to the point that they got. If, you know, it's just like anything, you know, if you paint your house every fifth
mechanism,
nobody was inspecting them. Nobody was going out and requiring.
Is the village ready to start going around inspecting sidewalks and making homeowners repair them or repair them and then sue them?
I think that if the council chooses to put that responsibility back on the property owner, that we have to come up with some way to inspect and enforce that.
Well, isn't that what the intern did with this severity map?
Well, the intern did the inventory, but there was no enforcement or anything like that.
Well, but I mean, so, the inventory is a big piece of it, is figuring out where the problem areas are.
That's correct. I mean, it changes regularly. I mean, it would be something that Jason would have to take on as a regular duty. And probably Denise would have to work with him on enforcement, just as she works with the police department on enforcement of other pieces of the zoning code. So, I mean, it would be a team effort, and we would figure it out if council chose to put that back on property owners. I think that putting it on the property owners without that kind of enforcement mechanism would be fairly useless.
I mean, we also have meter readers that are at each of these properties on a monthly basis, so
that's,
I mean,
true.
They could even, I mean, between the crews that we have out there with the streets and the meter readers visiting every, I mean, they walk all of these streets every single month. I mean, we'd have a mechanism in place in order to be able to flag them.
Yeah.
It's just a,
see, I think that
it's doable.
It still has to be
followed up on.
That person that,
correct,
but, you know, speaks for us for the enforcement of it and make sure that gets done. Mm-hmm.
Correct, but if you remember, one of the things that we talked about during the budget was that we were talking about getting Denise a part-time temporary person, mm-hmm. seasonal person, to help with that kind of thing.
Right.
So, I mean, that would be, you know, it's doable if council chooses to do it.
I probably would vote against changing it. Mm-hmm. I think that I don't see that a sidewalk benefits the homeowner any more than not having a sidewalk, and that it's an undue burden for the homeowner, and it is part of the transportation system. So probably I would vote against, but, you know, I'm just one. All you need is three.
Well, I will say this, I think, again, falls into identifying the problem we need to fix. So let's presume that we decide there are, you know, several neighborhoods that have these really bad sidewalks, and, you know, they are, it's a safety risk, or it's impeding transportation, or there's accessibility issues, then I think we tackle that problem. And, you know, and it's the same kind of thing. I mean, I could imagine incentivizing, you know, fixing. We've talked about, do we use some of that budget to share in the costs of that fixing? But I think this is where, kind of to Jerry's point, and what you were saying, Mary Ann, at the beginning, maybe those aren't the problems that we need to fix right now. So Dayton Street, West South College, I think there are some things to look at there. And then as other things come up, then we design strategies for those as well. And those could be a mixture of things.
And the expense, you know, I don't know, Brian didn't say this specifically, but it could be a small assessment. Again, maybe it's a shared assessment. So the village shares, but there is a small assessment or some amount of assessment to those property owners that goes on their property tax bill, so that it's not like they don't have to come out of pocket $5,000 or whatever it would be to repair those sidewalks. And I do believe if you have a nice sidewalk in front of your house, or if you have a crummy sidewalk in front of your house, it's going to make a difference on your property value if you are trying to sell your house. It is going to make a difference.
Well, but if a homeowner feels that way, they're quite able to repair their sidewalk if that's a concern for them.
But ultimately, it's a concern for the village, for accessibility for the village. What I'm saying is that there is a benefit to them to have to pay for that. There is, you know, they do see a benefit in it. So it's not just about, and I, you know, I understand the I'm definitely on the fence on this, but, you know, I think that there are ways we can look at it, since we cannot, as a village government, put the amount of money that needs to be put in these sidewalks. I don't think we can just absolutely eliminate the idea of some sort of shared partnership with property owners.
And I have to side with Mary Ann, and if we were to take a vote today, saying that I feel that sidewalks shouldn't be treated as transportation and be the village's responsibility, because we, are touting ourselves and we're trying to push people toward making Yellow Springs a more walkable, less car-driven community. Then we step up in the paper.
Well, we've talked about this for a long time.
Yeah.
And I mean, there are at least two pretty separate issues. Who pays for it's one issue. And then focusing on priorities and getting them fixed is, they're related, clearly, but they're another issue. So I'm thinking maybe we should take a vote at some time soon about who pays for it. Because
well,
otherwise
I don't think
we're
we need to take. I mean, until we until we, you know, kind of have a proposal, or I mean, I'm not ready to say, oh, I'm going to write, you know, I'm going to support an ordinance. I mean, it's just a conversation point. I'm not ready.
Well, I guess I'm just saying we need to stop just
talking. Do we have something on the books right now, an ordinance or something that says we will do?
Yes.
Okay, then we should do, or we should change. You know, we've been at this now for 2 years. So,
okay.
You know, and I hate to say it, but if it's there in writing, then I as a citizen would be expecting the village to do that or
right.
change it.
Right.
And not keep
right.
pushing it down the road.
But I guess what I'm hearing is something a little bit different, which is that we've got tasks for next year. And so I don't think we are at the point to have to vote who pays, right? I think status quo can address some of the problems that we've identified so far, and there's more work to be done, I think, on the bigger picture. So I do want to give one plug, by the way, for Complete Streets. I think if we pass an ordinance in this area, it could set us up in the future for certain grant funding and other things. So I do think that is something in the mix of this that we should prioritize.
Yes. Should we have Planning Commission look at that or transportation?
I think so. I mean, I to me, this is definitely a role for Planning Commission.
Mm-hmm.
I also wanted, this just came across my desk today. There's a webinar on December 6th at 3:00. Enabling an equitable transportation system with shared mobility. That sounds really excellent. I learned about it through Heritage Ohio. So I can send a link to folks. I'll send it to Judy, then she can send it out to folks. But this might be something that would be interesting. It certainly fits into the discussion right now. And thank you guys
did
good work.
A lot.
This was great. Yeah, I mean, we've got to talk about it again. You know, it's you know, we want to get something done, but we don't have the money to do it. So, you know, it's okay. What's next on the agenda? Sidewalk report, new business. We don't have any new business. Manager's report.
We have got over most of the stuff in my report already. The only thing we have not addressed is the annual wage adjustment for staff. This year, Melissa and I are recommending a 3% for employees. The average in the area is 2.5%, and the range is 2 to 3.5, depending on where you are and what union you may or may not belong to. I am going to recommend to council that we take that off the legislation for the December 5th meeting and move it to the January 3rd meeting to allow council more time for discussion on that topic.
And could you provide us with that survey
information? I'm still trying to find my notes on that.
And maybe look at communities that perhaps are smaller and not unionized, without a unionized workforce?
Yeah, we did the normal ones in the area that we normally do, but
okay.
We can try some of the smaller ones as well. Again, the fiber needs assessment survey will be released before we all go home for Thanksgiving, so please look for that survey link on the Village website, the Village Facebook page. I have asked my fiber advisory board to help spread the word on that. It's very important that we get as high a response as possible on that survey for the fiber needs assessment. I did attend a meeting of the Trail Management Committee last week at the Greene County Parks and Trails District. And I'm happy to report that we're getting a refund. Apparently, there was a paving project on the trail a couple of years ago, and there's some money left over. We are going to get a refund for $25,427.11, and Melissa will be putting that back into the Parks and Rec Capital Fund, which is where it came from in the first place. So that's where that's going to go. Again, the Planning and Zoning Office will be closed for most of the month of December. I will be handling the run-of-the-mill easy permits during that time. Anything major, such as a variance or a conditional use, we'll have to wait until Denise returns.
Do we have some kind of a fallback? I don't anticipate this happening. It would be great if a large project came forward. I don't want to tell somebody with a nice big project, sorry, you have to come back in a month.
If push comes to shove, between Judy, myself, and Jessica, we can get it done.
Okay.
It's better to wait for Denise to come back if we can.
Okay, thank you.
Two other things that are not in my report. One is the Ellis Park Boardwalk and Glass Farm Boardwalk that Brian mentioned earlier. Trail Symposium, correct, is where this comes out of. They do a volunteer kind of a learning workshop project every year. So when they come here next May, when they come to Dayton next May for the Trail Symposium, we have spoken to them about doing a project here in Yellow Springs, and it will either be at the Glass Farm, which is a boardwalk, which I will let Brian explain, or at Ellis Park. We spoke to them about putting a bridge up over the spillway because folks are trying to walk across the spillway and it's really mossy and slimy and they fall and that's not good. So we've talked to them about that as well as a potential bridge up over the drainage ditch in the back to get people into the Arboretum. So that is one of the projects that they are considering doing, and they're supposed to get back to us about that. And then, Brian, do you want to talk about the boardwalk at the Glass Farm?
That's actually Mary Ann.
Okay.
Do you want to talk about it now or later? Or?
Well, there's an issue in terms of the path at the wetlands area, and that issue is the culvert that then runs under King Street. It's very difficult to cross over the culvert. You can walk along the beaver dam, but that's a little precarious too.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe that someone from Cincinnati, is that right, is going to come and see if it's possible to put a boardwalk that probably would go west of the beaver dam itself and cross over the wetlands a little bit from one side to the other side.
So is that the preferred project, if it works?
Well, that was what we started talking about.
Yeah, that's what we started with. I think the story, well, they're both good stories. I mean, you know, I think the bottom line is they would like to do a project in Yellow Springs. And did they confirm someone from Cincinnati coming up? Did Mike?
He did not with me, no.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll remind him. But he did mention that, so.
The only thing I would submit about Ellis is that we have had a serious incident there, and it's something that we have discussed. And it's an old priority, and sometimes it's nice to get those old priorities taken care of first. That I would be happy either way.
Yeah. He was intrigued because it was a bridge. For some reason, he felt like that was intriguing. And then the last thing that I have I just want to quickly let everybody know. For those of you who know engineers, you know that they like to change firms frequently. And when we started the process for the water plant, Sam Swanson, who is our criteria engineer, worked for Burgess and Nipel. And then Sam Swanson left Burgess and Nipel and went to HNTB, which is where we ultimately chose our criteria engineer from. And now Sam is back with Burgess and Nipel because they have lured him back. So you will in the future, and Chris and I have talked about this, you will in the future see legislation that ends our contract with HNTB, and HNTB wants us to end our contract with them because we want to stay with Sam as our criteria engineer. So we will be ending our contract with HNTB and writing a contract with exactly the same remaining conditions with Burgess and Nipal to keep Sam as our criteria engineer on the water plant. So it'll be two pieces of legislation that will come through. One will end the contract with HNTB. The other one will allow me to sign a contract with Burgess and Nipal. The reason that we don't have to bid this out, and Chris, if I get this wrong, please correct me, is there is an exception to the bidding that says if the person has an intimate knowledge of the of the project.
The project, if it involves equipment, building, et cetera, et cetera, certainly Sam's experience in this process would be difficult to substitute somebody in without time and expense.
And is Burgess and Nipal accepting liability for Sam's entire period of time? Or okay. Are you sure? Make sure that gets into it.
Yeah.
Any update on the bike corral?
Jason told me that it was supposed to be in last week, but he was out sick one day last week, and I'm not sure if it came in or not.
Okay. So and Sharrow's on?
He did talk to me a little bit about the Sharrow's. He said if he wants to put down the reflective glass in them, and he's afraid if he puts it down now that he'll just plow it up again when he plows the snow. So he did ask if council wanted him to go ahead and just paint the Sharrow's without the reflective glass in them, or if you want to wait until spring and put down the ones with the reflective glass.
What do you think?
And how hard is it to add that later? You know, like have it down?
Well, you have to repaint them again. I mean, they're in the paint. So
then you'll probably have to repaint them again after the weather, right?
Yeah.
So the question is, do you want to paint them? I mean, it's the end of November. It's probably going to start.
I mean, weren't we talking about a few hundred dollars?
I think he said it was $250 to paint them on just on South College for right now. Yes.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So, yeah, I think
so paint them now without the glass beads, and then if we repaint the next time we repaint, put the glass beads in,
and then it's possible we'll have a resolution for Dayton Street. We're probably not ready to. We talked about it on Dayton Street, but maybe hold up on that since we really haven't heard from the Active Transportation Committee yet. But maybe by spring there will be a little bit broader. Look at how where other places to put Sharrow's.
Yeah. Right.
And then do those.
Yeah, well, we know that we want to put them down Xenia and Dayton Street at least.
Right. So. And I think, you know, paint is cheap, and, you know, this is, you know, as we did with the bike corral, piloting things and trying them and tweaking them. Yep.
So, and that's all I have.
Okay.
Melissa.
Melissa?
I didn't put a formal report in the packet because there wasn't really anything major, but I will add that our first data extraction of our utility billing data occurred a week ago, and the new billing company is working with that. There will be three data extractions total, so this is the first one where they've been able to take our data and start doing some testing on it. I had mentioned to Judy at the beginning of the meeting, we may need a supplemental appropriation at the next meeting. I need to take a look at the budget to see if there's any areas that would require a supplemental, since that'll be right before the end of the year, just to make sure that we're all in line. And then I'm just preparing for end of the year stuff and then preparing financial statements. So that's it for me.
Okay. Judy?
Yeah, same kind of preparing for end of year stuff in my area as well. Again, there's a BZA meeting on November 28th at 7 o'clock, and we have openings on Energy Board as well as on Arts and Culture Commission. So do tell your friends and neighbors.
Okay. Next is Board and Commission reports. We'll start with Jerry, Planning Commission.
Planning Commission is not having a meeting in December. Unless we're called out for an emergency and so forth. During the month of December, we are going to be looking at the comprehensive plan.
Yes.
And for discussion in January.
Okay.
What we've charged ourselves to do is spend the month of December going over and making notes so we can start having discussions on the plan.
Okay.
Gary, did you want to say anything about the lot survey, or do you want to just hold on to that? The Planning Commission had talked about that it would be really useful for them to have a lot survey.
A lot survey, right, for the whole village.
Right. As they sort of move forward into the comprehensive plan.
Right.
That may come before you.
So that's something that council may want to look at the beginning of the year.
Anything on finance? I assume not, since we're budgeting and all through all that.
You know, but I do have to compliment Melissa. You know, we had a real good session in the beginning of last year, but when she came on board, and she is keeping everybody on council satisfied, so we haven't had to meet that much.
Good. Yes. Thanks. Brian?
So we have three nominations for the Economic Sustainability Commission, and I believe council had some information about those three folks. So we have one permanent position because several months ago Taki resigned, and so we are recommending for that position nominating Dino Pallotta. I think we all know that he owns a very successful small business downtown, and we realize that that is an important voice to represent on the commission that's not completely covered right now. And then we have two alternate positions. Adam Abraham has been busy with Planning Commission and other things, so he's stepping back. And so the one we are nominating, Luciana Leaf, who's got a real estate background, is trained as a police officer, got a lot of interesting history, and lives in town, of course. And the second alternate, Susan Jennings, who I think we all know from Community Solutions, executive director, very interested in local investment, and actually, I discovered, owned her own business for 15 years, which I thought was pretty cool, a small business. Any questions? Yep. All right. So I would like to move to nominate those three individuals for those spots.
Second. Do I call the vote? I guess I call the vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
And then otherwise, with the Economic Sustainability Commission, we already talked about the upcoming forum and that being virtually planned, and we're working on the revolving loan fund. I think I mentioned at our last meeting that Sandy Hollenberg from the Federal Credit Union here in town attended our meeting and could handle that piece of having the financial expertise, which is something we knew we would need if we revived the revolving loan fund. So we've got some funds now. There's been some good research on adding more to that fund once we get the policy in place. And then for the Arts and Culture Commission, Judy, thanks for mentioning that we do have a couple spots. And also, we have been working on refining the guidelines for the Bryan Center Community Gallery. We may have some art displayed soon.
Yeah, I hope so. We're trying to get it a date right now to hang that. Yes.
And then, Patty, I wanted to ask you, did we get any proposals for the new sign?
We got the one that I sent to you for the solar. Other than that, we did not.
Okay. So do you think we should extend it, or?
I'd like to think about that a little bit.
I don't know if anybody noticed, but the very decrepit sign that had, long-standing sign that had been sitting in the side yard of the Winds with, that was to promote Dayton Street merchants, was removed. I think everybody thought that had been on the Winds property. It's actually village property where it was sitting. It just there's been a lot of discussion going around in circles about what should be there, where it should go, what it should be about. So that was removed by Jason just last week. I would wonder, and I think you actually might get more interest in something, a proposal for that sign.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you want to, you know, if you want to change directions, but it's just something I would submit that I think that it's probably something for which an artistic rendering would be, something more creative would be a little bit more exciting. So
we're not going to go with the design that we had previously?
I think it's something that can be potentially considered. So just, I don't know if you want to think about it.
Yeah, well, let's talk about it at the next Arts and Culture meeting.
Okay. Judith is not here, but Mary Ann, do you have any information on her commissions?
Not on the Energy Board, not on the Library.
Hold on. Sounds like Energy.
Energy Board did meet. One of the things that we're discussing is appropriate uses of the money that we previously spent on Efficiency Smart.
Excuse me.
Our contract, as Council knows, the motion was to withdraw from the Efficiency Smart program. So our contract with that program runs through December 31st. We're talking about ways to use the funds more effectively here in the village, different types of rebate programs, low-flow showerheads, weatherproofing homes. We have a speaker coming to the January meeting to talk about energy assessments in your home. I've been contacted by a couple of the larger businesses, such as YSI and Antioch College, about some of the larger rebates that, you know, they have things in progress that they'd like to see. And so those things are all being considered by the Energy Board.
Okay.
And the next meeting is the 13th of December.
Are they potentially losing funding that they were expecting or losing rebates that they were expecting?
For YSI, that is the potential. Antioch doesn't have anything in there right now, but the gentleman from YSI is coming to the next Energy Board meeting to speak to them about that. So.
Okay, I think that's important.
Right.
Unfortunately, it was a question I had not asked, and I wish I would have. Don't know if it was considered
the
Energy Board.
We knew that there would be things that we would have to catch up, things that were in progress that maybe wouldn't get finished out. And then the Library Commission did not meet. The next meeting is December the 6th.
Okay. Mary Ann?
Yeah, so Pat Deweese is here from the Justice System Task Force, and I think she is sitting there patiently.
Thank you,
that
Pat.
She could give a report.
Sure.
Can you come up to the microphone?
I can do that.
I've got my little report here in case there's questions. So we've met twice. We've created five subcommittees, and each of those subcommittees, and I can just quickly tell you sort of the obvious ones, looking at the mayor's court, looking at the village police department, a group that is looking at public perceptions and process for building community trust with the justice system. A fourth group is looking at reform and various kinds of research around the country with a focus on restorative justice and other community policing reforms that are happening. So they're just looking at what's happening. And then there are two high school students, this is pretty exciting, who've decided that they will be on the committee and they will try to build an educational program within the high school. And they're just starting to talk with teachers and I don't know whether they've actually talked to the chief yet or not, but they plan to. So that's kind of, that's neat that they're doing that. And we pretty much agreed that we would try by January to finish phase one, and phase one being that each of these groups would have would really be able to report on kind of status quo. Where are things now? What are the issues now? And in some cases that might be reporting out data, other cases perception. For example, the group that's looking at public perception, they're talking about having some level of a survey So we would sort of do the status quo in January, if at all possible. So people, that's kind of a goal. And we did have a speaker last Thursday, the 17th. We had invited Thomas Hagel, who is an emeritus professor of law from the University of Dayton. And we were advertising him as someone who would talk about the Constitution, which turned out to be, as a public meeting, it was not wildly popular. Ooh. We didn't have a lot of people. But I think he was very helpful to the committee, as well as to the few people who were there, in terms of laying out some of the issues that he saw, particularly in regard to Mayor's Court. So that was sort of our first attempt to hold a public event that would educate the community a little bit more. Questions?
Okay. Thanks, Pat.
Thank you. Yep.
Continue on, Marianne.
Okay, I have not met regarding the school board. Human Relations Commission, we reviewed the Indigenous Peoples resolution and awarded two grants, one for the Elaine Comegys Film Festival and one for what's called Day of Empowerment for high school students that deals with gender issues, bias issues, and things like that. Environmental Commission focused on how to get more input from the community on the Climate Action Plan, and then began a continued discussion about the lawn ordinance that came back to the Environmental Commission because of something that the Planning Commission caught. Also then, regarding the glass farm work, we started putting in a parking area, as we had said we were going to do, and a neighbor was concerned about the location. We had a meeting with her, and Patty Bates was at that meeting, and a few other neighbors had some input with questions, good questions, on things like how was this area going to be maintained and treated, and when could people come in, that sort of thing. So we don't have answers to all those questions, but what we are doing is we're going to send out a letter to all the neighbors to invite them on December 4th, which is a Sunday. I think I'm going to just check that.
Yeah, it is Sunday.
Sunday at 1:00, which will be the day before our next council meeting, to walk the area of the wetlands so neighbors can get acquainted with the area and have any other questions or input that they want to have. We're also going to look to see whether it makes sense to try and move this little parking area. It's a small parking area for several cars. So, and also honeysuckle removal has been started on the glass farm. Okay, the Beaver Management Task Force. First of all, I'd like to say that Jerry and I and Vicki Hennessy interviewed Becca Eastman, whose name I think I submitted information about her before. I'm not sure that I have. But Becca Eastman lives at Thistle Creek. She's married to Nick Eastman. She teaches science at the middle school. Mm-hmm. She's had her classes last year work in the wetlands, gathering information about the wetlands. And she has indicated and has been participating in the beaver management team. So we would like to we'd like to nominate her as the last member of the beaver management team.
Second.
Second.
Okay, so.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 So the beaver management team was, you know, really created for work on the glass farm. And last weekend, we made and installed two flow devices in two dams on the headwaters of the Yellow Springs Creek. And one of those dams is on village property. The other dam is between Thistle Creek and Rick Donahoe's property. And they work. Those flow devices work. We spent all day Saturday and part of Sunday putting them in. However, those wily beavers, after we did that, they plugged up the culvert at Thistle Creek. And so we are in the process of figuring out how to put a, I mean, we, it's possible to put a flow device in there, but, you know, the weather's changed. It's sort of cold getting in that water now. It was cold last week, too. We do have waders, but still. So that's the next thing. Once we get that handled, then that water should flow through that area. So as you, as some people know anyway, another group of beavers, as was reported to council, came to Ellis Pond, or Ellis Park. And so people from the beaver management team, as well as some people from the tree committee, have been wrapping trees in the arboretum and in Ellis Park. And at this point, I'm not sure who all has paid for some of that fencing material, but I know Vicki Hennessy has. And I guess I won't make the request now, but I'll come back to council with a request that any money that the beaver management team puts into wrapping those trees gets reimbursed by the village. Then I will say that, you know, those beavers came, that family of beavers, a mom, a dad, two babies, and two yearlings. And we were initially told by the county soil and water department that they would let the beavers stay and that they were going to remove the dam. I talked to the representative and told him we were quite capable of putting in a flow device. He did not take my request to do that. He said that he would have an engineer come and remove the dam. And that was, they waited about a month, I think. And of course, the water rate got higher and higher and higher. And then most recently, we were told that they were going to trap and kill the beavers. And they haven't done that yet. But so I'm pretty displeased about their lack of willingness to work with us and the fact that they didn't do anything for about a month. And then they are going back on what they said they were going to do. So my understanding is, was it the village that was it Jason's crew that removed the dam? Or?
Jason's crew went out and breached. There are actually five dams out there now, and Jason's crew went out and breached two of them to lower the level of the water enough to keep it from overflowing the banks. And they've, because of the efforts to wrap the trees, they've actually started just going and getting corn stalks out of the neighboring fields and built two of the dams with corn stalks. So they're pretty innovative. But yes, it was Jason's crew that breached two of the dams just to get the flow going a little bit.
So, and that, well, that water comes from various farm fields, even that go into Clark County, I guess, and tiles probably in those fields and maybe springs that come into that water, and then it eventually joins with the Yellow Springs Creek and crosses over into DeWine Pond. And at some point, the village agreed to have this soil and water, county soil water, manage that area that's on the village property.
So, but they manage everything else.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, they manage that whole drainage ditch. So that's my report.
Okay. Thanks. Green County Regional Planning, we had actually a relatively short meeting. We're talking about budget things, but I did want to let council know, I think all of you were on council last year when they put the bylaws forward that changed the funding structure for membership and had one fee that was 25 cents per capita for small municipalities and townships and 10 cents per capita for the large municipalities. My recollection, because I think I was actually out at the time, I wasn't at the meeting, that council rejected that those bylaws, voted no to those bylaws. Bellbrook also voted no, and they're one of the other communities. So it's us, Bellbrook, Cedarville, Jamestown.
So now that we're going through the budget again, I've raised that issue again as to why, and I wrote a letter, and I can get it, a copy to you. We spoke about it at length at our last, we had an executive committee meeting last week. We spoke at length about it. I mean, we're talking about around $2,000 to regional planning, to their budget, if they would take all the municipalities down to the same amount of money. So, and the irony is that there are no large municipal members anyway. So, we are going to be, the executive committee is going to be attending a Greene County Commission planning session, and we will make our case. And I think I did, I actually did convince the executive committee of my position. And so we're going to go with some figures, some budget figures, and try to convince the commissioners that they don't really need that extra $2,000, and that the benefit to regional planning and to the county outweighs that unnecessarily penalty to small communities. So hopefully council is in support of that. Okay. Looking forward to the next meeting, which we, December 5th, we added, Brian asked for sidewalks to be added. Anything else? Did we add anything else?
Melissa did want the supplemental appropriation as an emergency, as a just in case, on December 5th. And then we moved the employee and wage scales to the 3rd.
Right, and but we will have your contract, right?
Yes.
Potentially, yeah, Judy?
It's kind of up to you guys.
Okay, well, we'll
discussing it still.
Right. Okay, let's leave it off for now. We'll decide. We'll talk about it.
Not to throw another wrench in the works, but we still have 6 months. My mistake. Go ahead.
Right. I know your contract. So your contract is a June contract, right? Is
that correct?
Okay.
It is evaluation time. But.
Right. I know, and that is something council that I have to start working on. Unfortunately, although I think it was Brian and I that worked on it last year, Lori was always great at doing that too. We need to put together a process for evaluation of both Judy and Patty. And that's probably obviously going to be moved into the new year.
I've got
a whole pile of stuff too. So it's looking like, unless something major happens at the next meeting, like we will be able to cancel the December, the second meeting in December. And I guess the only thing I would say is if anything is coming to us from your commissions from the rest of this month, just to bring it, we'll take a few minutes at the December 5th meeting to discuss it, since we won't have that second meeting. Anything else? Does anyone want to make a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thanks all.
Thank you.